All right, next up, we've got Hudson Martins. Welcome, Hudson.
Hi, guys. Hi, Chris. How are you doing?
Excellent. So give us a little background on Hudson Martins. Tell us about yourself.
All right, talking about myself. So I'm Hudson Martins. I manage the effects team in the Axis Studios. We are like roughly 300 people right now, and I'll talk about a bit more about Axis Studios. My background comes from Houdini effects. Actually, I was studying engineering before I found out I wanted to work with games, and I was living in Sweden, started working in Sweden, a company called Milford. Eventually moved to join Axis to do some effects for Halo, and I, you know, fell in love, got stuck with the team, started building the team up from, we were three team members back then. Nowadays, we're between 20, 25 across multiple fields. Houdini is our main software. So yeah, it's been quite a cool journey. And that's essentially what this talk will be about that journey of from being an artist to managing a team, what is necessary as well.
You guys do amazing work. We're all big fans over here. So what's your presentation going to be about today?
Like I mentioned, the presentation is something slightly different than most presentations you have around the Houdini sphere. We'll be talking much more about leadership, supervision, managing teams. I don't know if you've noticed, but it's a very few people who actually focus on the area. We're artists from the base. We want to do amazing effects. We'll learn a lot about Houdini. Eventually, sometimes we become leaders or supervisors or managers, still with the same focus of, you know, the art, the software. Very seldom we put focus, emphasizes on what is needed to create a team, to make it sustainable, to make it self-going, to make sure the culture of the team is good as possible. And that is the area I want to touch base today. And it's something that's quite common in games, you know, but not so much in the visual effects frontier. And I can say by being a person who has to recruit a lot, there's not a lot of people who naturally are doing this as a focus and want to understand what is needed to become an amazing leader. My goal is to show to you guys what I do myself, but also from other companies, and show the spectrum, the variety of leaders there are in other companies as well as Axis.
Excellent. Well, looking forward to it. Let's dive in.
Let's do this.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to this talk. My name is Hudson Martins. I'm head of effects in Axis Studios, and this talk is very different in the Houdini world. It is actually about leadership. I do use Houdini on a daily basis almost, but something that we never discuss and talk about is actually leadership, how to be a leader. What tools can you actually put in front of yourself and support your team and yourself throughout that journey? Because let's be honest, it requires a little bit more than just knowing VEX, right? So looking forward for you to continue this talk. We'll be talking about three pillars where I believe, is for me at least, are essential to surviving as a leader. This is also based on a few interviews I've had with other head of effects from other companies, smaller and larger, as well as effects supervisors, effects leads, effects artists, TDs, CFX, CG supervisors. So I'm trying to collate a lot of information, sharing about my experience. And like always, we're always learning. So this is not set in stone. This is the findings I've had throughout my 4 years doing the role and developing from basically being a pure artist to managing a team of 20 people, soon to be 30 people as well. Before I go further, I want to talk a little bit more about Axis Studios. Really quickly, this is where I work. They gave me opportunity of becoming a leader. And until today, since 4 years ago, 5 years ago, I'm still doing so, enjoying it. Here's the reel. The reason I'm showing the reel is to give you the rough identity of our company. We do such a large variety of different projects and effects, everything from real time, 2D effects, visual effects, loads of pre-rendered animation effects as well, which is probably how most people recognize us from Halo and Destiny and those kind of games and League of Legends. So let's play, and I hope you enjoy. Bang it.
Bad for you, run boy run. They're trying to catch you, run boy run. Running is a victory, run boy run. Beauty lies behind the hills. Run boy run. The sun will be guiding you. Run, boy, run. They're dying to stop you. Run, boy, run. This race is a prophecy. Run, boy, run. Break out from society. War is another day, hey. And you won't have to hide away, yeah. You'll be a man, boy. But for now, it's time to run, it's time to run. Tomorrow is another day, hey. When the night fades away, yeah. You'll be a man, boy. But for now, it's time to run, it's time to run.
All right, I hope this gave you a bit of a understanding of what we do on a daily basis, and it's pretty cool. So my role is head of effects, as I mentioned, and I actually only have one task, and it is to make sure effects in Axis works. And like myself, other managers and other head of effects as well, we have one target when we do this, and it's actually to make ourselves redundant. It's actually to make the team don't need us as managers, which is very surprising because it's like you're working against your own role, but that's essentially the dream of a manager. If your team doesn't need you, you've done an amazing job. Just a little background. So I started my career in Stockholm, Sweden, and I worked in a company called Milford Film. Great company, great people, smaller studio, definitely. And we did a lot of full CG animation. I was lucky enough to start working with Houdini straight off the bat. Loved the software. And Axis, I joined them because I loved Halo. So I joined Axis, started doing Halo projects, and they gave me opportunity to lead the effects team. And by that time, we were three people, you know, just like three friends. And I had no idea what journey I was going to. And I said, yeah, okay, let's go. You know, just like the GIF you see below, somehow that role scared me as a big dragon, and I decided, well, let's do it. If I won't do it, we've been trying to find the right person for the position. I give it a go, and now we are roughly 20 artists across so many disciplines, and soon we'll be hitting 30 people as well end of this year. So that's exciting, actually, tenfolds in 4 years. So it's quite an interesting journey. We're roughly 300 people, both freelancers and permanent employees, in three studios, London, Bristol, and Glasgow, mainly based in Scotland and England. And honestly, like, we are doing pre-rendered work, real-time work, both in-engine for games, cinematics, as well as rendered engine cinematics. In our team, we also have 2D effects artists who actually draw, you know, for more stylized projects and everything in between. So the team is quite generalist. Obviously, you have some specialists, people who do 2D effects, they're more specialized, but it's really, really interesting. I love it. As I mentioned before, this presentation is from a few things I've learned throughout doing the role, as well as information I've got from some amazing people who took their time to speak to me before this presentation or interviews, sharing information about how it is to be a leader. I know a few friends who are head of effects in other companies. Some are actually competitors. Some others are larger or smaller. And we all have similar problems, similar goals, similar struggles. That's why I'm sharing this. Also, let's bear in mind, most of us came from art background. We wanted to start doing Houdini to become artists. Very few of us thought, well, wait, can you be a leader, a manager as well? So we might have a lot of people who are supervisors, who are amazing at the software, but never really realize there are so many other tools that can make themselves and the team perform even better. And that's if you focus a little bit on the leadership stuff. So I'm actually staying away from any Houdini in this presentation, unlike me. And I'm glad Side Effects gave me the opportunity to do so. So let's go. I believe in three pillars. That's what I'm going to be talking about. One is empathy. I'll explain what I mean by empathy, but this applies to any level of your work, of your understanding. Applies between companies, between people, projects, roles, individuals, even your own vaccines, culture. It's such a big thing. And day in, day out, there's something I constantly practice, because it's like fitness. If you stop, you know, it goes a certain direction. If you keep going, you can build on it. And survival. Survival is what makes anyone grow, in my opinion. Being scared of something is good. Being scared of something is very good. Surviving that thing you were just scared about makes you never be scared about that again. I'll be talking a little bit about that as well. So let's go to your first point, which is empathy. Okay, it's a lot of text. Don't worry about it. Imagine this, you open a Houdini scene as a comprehensive, complex scene, but you understand all these nodes. You understand how the nodes are interconnected. You understand why certain attributes are being used. You understand how the intrinsic attributes are being used. You understand the Python scripts that go into that scene. That is one part of empathy, is understanding how it works. The next part is, how can you solve that problem? Because there is a problem in that scene. By having a large understanding, you're actually able to easily know what to do to solve the problem. So for me, empathy is not necessarily just, you know, caring about others always. It's actually about having a certain amount of perspective on your surroundings and other people and other projects, the situation they are in, situation they go through. And then it's another step, which is care. And for me, care is the ability to act, to help, to solve the problem, solve the dispute, making sure that you kind of prioritize where you put your energy. This is actually easily forgotten, and this is how I paint empathy. It takes time to learn. I've been learning this throughout time, and the last year and a half is when I really realized how this has helped me so much, because I still do a lot of Houdini tasks now and then. I still manage a team, do recruiting, do planning for projects, supervise projects. I also talk to the CEO and head of CGs about strategies, how we're going to do in the future. And being in all these discussions across the board gives me, luckily, a high and a good perspective of how a lot of people within the company is feeling and working. And this is what I'm going to talk about as well. The first step for myself, at least, when it came to gaining a higher sense of empathy within this work scenario, was to understand how I work. How am I as a leader? And I'll be honest with you, I'm not the most organized leader. I go a bit more about the gut feeling. I'm much more, you know, about in close contact with people, getting to know people, who my surroundings. Some people are great at planning. Knowing that aspect of myself and working, I make sure whoever I'm pairing with, I'm cooperating with, are slightly my opposite. You know, they fill in the gaps that I'm not amazing at. And that's a little bit about knowing yourself, and it takes time. You need to ask those questions: how you're reacting in certain circumstances, how you're solving certain problems, why is it taking longer than you should, and so on. Once accept yourself, actually understand and accept how you are as a person, because everyone's different, you can start listening more. Basically, this is why I struggled the most at the beginning, because I have all these opinions and thoughts, and I just want to share those. I pushed that back, and I started to listening much more to the teams, to other senior supervisors, head of departments, and I'm able to actually go through all the noise and realize what I actually have to do to make this happen, or to solve this conflict, or to solve that problem. So for me, empathy is perspective and care, in terms of understanding what goes within the system, and the care is how to adjust that, where you should adjust it, and when. First point, empathy, guys. Imagine if it was a node in Houdini, it'd be one of the good ones. Culture, all right, day in, day out, culture. Sorry for repeating myself. Culture is the identity, like culture is the ingrained identity of what your company, what your team, what yourself, what your project are trying to aim for. A good culture is similar to a good Mandelbaum. You know, you have those repetitive patterns. Doesn't matter how deep into it you go, it's the same pattern, repetitive. Everyone knows how it should look like. Doesn't matter if you're intern in the company, doesn't matter if you're CEO in the company, everyone shares that culture. This is not company level, team level should be the same. Where a bad culture can easily crash your Houdini file, and has happened to me, and yeah, you know, a bad Mandelbaum, that's what it does. It's difficult to measure culture. You need a certain amount of, how do you call it, emotional intelligence. On the other hand, there are ways of measuring culture, because since I work in many projects at the same time, I can notice different cultures, different projects. And one of the key things that measures that I've noticed is how well the teams are able to take decisions. Doesn't matter if they're the right decisions or wrong, because we all do mistakes, but it's the how quick is that happening? How easily are the team buy in on the decision making behind every step of the process? And that's how you measure a certain culture. Because if decision making is easy and it's not just top down driven by one person, you have a certain amount of culture belief. Everyone knows when they face a problem, what they actually should do and what's the goal within your team, within your company. Then all of a sudden you have this cohesive culture within that team or company. And you can ask yourself, why is actually good? And I'll do this. I mean, Cristiano Ronaldo is an amazing football player, but he doesn't play 11 man. He can't be 11 man in the pitch. So you need a team to create amazing things. You need to work as a team. He needs a team that works well with him. 11 Cristiano Ronaldo's, maybe a goalkeeper, he's not a goalkeeper, probably wouldn't play that well unless they create this amazing culture, obviously. So one of the things I actually usually ask is in an interview, and I think I always ask that now, it's my first question, and it is what the person does outside of work. Not Houdini, not CG, what they like to do. And you'd be amazed what kind of answers you get, everything from love inventing new machines I build with my 3D printer. And it's the main reason I do this is because I can look at a person's reel, I can look at the CV, I can see a lot of information where the person has been working, what schools, for how long, what they've uploaded on Vimeo. That's normal facts. I'm actually looking for someone that will fit within our team, that will share the same cultural beliefs. And let's face it, all the companies have different cultural beliefs. And that's important to know. So that's actually what I'm doing most of the interviews, is getting understanding of, is this person the person that will fit the team? Is this a team player? Because we are a team. So that's how I approach it. And several people do similar aspects of it, which I believe, at least in the long run, it's worth it. There are a few sayings, you should reflect a company culture or not. One of them is during crunch time and crazy hours, you know, you have this thing that says, pain is temporary, but glory is forever. I remember even, I think a director told me that once when we had to do so much effects in a project, and I understood it. I do have other beliefs as well, and it's something someone else told me, it's, well, Hudson, like whatever you do, how much time you spend on something, how much effort you put, your achievements will be on the credits. People will see it. People may cry. People may react to it. But your experience creating it, it's the memory that will sustain for the rest of your lives. And for you who work in projects, you know that feeling of delivering a project that was difficult, delivering a film that was difficult. As much as you love the fact that maybe you're on screen, you know, your name is on the credits, and people shows their gratitude towards you for accomplishing it, the thing that really, really sticks in your memory is that feeling, how it was working with your team, how it was working with people around you, And that for me is such an important value that goes beyond salary and the job role, because end of the day, that's what companies like ourselves, any company in the world, can actually provide people who are willingly to spend their time working with you. So that's why you should focus on culture. That's at least what I do. This is cool. Survival. Survival is probably what I'll put tool sets and what I'll put solutions in place and trying to keep going, because it's the best way of learning. Simple as that. Look at that GIF. And that's how we feel sometimes. You know, being a leader, you're much more alone. Your team, they rely on your decision making. You hold yourself accountable for what you decide. And you hope that your team, you know, okay, guys, for this case, I have one bullet. We have 300 zombies. Actually, it's 1,250, I think, when I did it the first time. And, you know, trust me, this is probably the right decision for this point in time. And when you have your backup from your team, that's an amazing feeling. But surviving is what you always need to keep in mind, because when you survive a project which is difficult, or survive a growth, or need to hire to make sure that your team grows, and you survive that, the feeling of scare you had at that point, that disappears. Next time the same issue, problem comes along, you're quite fine with it. It doesn't feel as you only have one bullet left, because you have so much knowledge. One of the quotes from one of the head of effects I interviewed for this talk, he said, "Well, I usually always tell the team yesterday's achievements are today's standard, so we're never satisfied." And they do amazing, amazing work, right? I look at their work and like, this is so beautiful. But that's their motto, and it clearly tells you, both establish a culture which is, we survive, we learn from it, as well as the importance of surviving. One good example I have for myself is, I was freaking out, absolutely freaking out, when I realized I had to grow the team from 3 people to 7 people in a few months. It might sound like little for some of you who might work in a, you know, film industry, and you're doing a film and you're hiring 40 people. You know, it happens. But when it's in Axis, you're based in Glasgow, and this was 4 years ago, small. And here's the worst part. I felt I've never been a leader. I've actually had to learn how to lead projects, as well as hire a lead to lead projects with me and the other leads and supervisors. Meanwhile, I haven't been interviewing a lot of people before in my life. So the thought of needing to double the team size back then scared me. And I called my friend, one of my best friends who still lives in Sweden. And we talked almost every night, and I talked him through the process of, yeah, I'm going through this. He was in something similar. He works in hotel industry, but he was going through something similar. And he told me, "Well, Hudson, just keep going, man. Just keep surviving. Just see it through. See what happens." And 2 years ago, 2 years later, we had to grow again from 10 to 20. And I have to be honest with you, I barely felt that. It was like challenging, but it did not feel as challenging as going from 3 people to 7. That's when I noticed, okay, by surviving these 2 years, all these lessons I've had, I've learned so much from it, and I'm actually able to apply it to the next challenge. So survival for me is like one of the key things. In any case, the main lesson here is keep surviving and you learn more. And as harsh as it sounds, that is actually the truth. And it's really cool. It's really impressive. I've grown so much as a person when I started being a leader. All right, so let's go to a few tools, because people do ask me, and I've been interviewing a few people for FX leads roles and supervisors. One of the common questions is, you know, how much time you spend doing tasks if you go into that role, how much responsibilities, how much support will I get, how's your pipeline, so on, so on. And one of the things I usually tell people is that mental capacity is a resource, and it works in a different way when you're able to focus, and when you actually have to concentrate really hard to listen to your team members, to others, to your supervisors, head of departments, you know, whoever you're interacting with. and when you actually have to take decision making on the fly, or really focus to decide how to move forward in the future. You'd be surprised how quickly you run out of that. Here's a good comparison. For those of you who have easily spent 16 hours one day just in Houdini, you get a bit tired, right? After 6 hours, you're like, lunch, a bit tired. But you keep going, you get into this zone, and you forget time. You forget this 11 o'clock, and it's dark outside. It's easy. You're fully in control. Your only focus is the problem solving. You're almost playing, having fun, almost playing games. But when you spend that day going through meetings and actually having to focus on a different level, having to shift your focus, it's different projects, different problems, different people. Maybe even go back and do an effect in Houdini for a few hours, then back to interview. That dries your mental capacity in a different manner. That's why I notice I'm knackered after 6 hours. I could easily sit in Houdini for 14 hours. So what I start doing is whenever I have difficult decision-making points or things that really need to focus, or even talk to artists or supervisors and support them the best I possibly can, I always book that in the mornings. Like, you know, that's the early mornings. That's what we do in the early mornings. It's the problem solving. Later in the afternoon, there's a lot of the times is it doing. So keep that in mind. See if it works for you. Focus time is, well, quite correlated to that. This is actually a way you can protect your team or the people who really need to go down in focus. Keep in mind that mental capacity is a resource. Let's say you have one of or a few of your TDs and artists having to solve problems for others and going to meetings across the whole day. You know, spend maybe half an hour here at 10 o'clock, half an hour just before lunch. Then after lunch, there's a 1 hour meeting, there's another meeting. That day, for someone who has to be creating art, that loves to be creating art, that can be quite tiresome. And they can easily come out of that day feeling they've done nothing. So one of the things I put in place, and we tried it in effects, is we call it effects time block. So between 11 and 4, everyone just blocked in the calendar. So producers and, you know, anyone who needed contact with the team, and it was especially outside the project, basically never booked any meetings during those times. So people could just focus on their own tasks. It did help a lot. It helped because then you kind of gave the power to every team member, intern, to a senior, to supervisors and leads, to say, hey, let's keep it for later in the afternoon or tomorrow morning, because at the moment we are focusing on getting these shots out. That's a good thing. Lastly is the way I like to prioritize things. I prioritize things based on a balanced, non-balanced approach. Super weird. I actually don't believe in a balanced lifestyle. I do believe in it in long run. So that's what I want to talk about. I believe when you are able to grind something, I'm not talking about just late hours. I'm talking about when you're able to really focus on a subject for a few hours, or a few days, or a few weeks, that's when you're able to really outperform your previous self. So the graph here to the left shows just like the difference between like a perfect balance. You have two tasks, let's say it's recruiting and supervising a project. And sometimes I say, okay, pause recruiting completely. If you look at the right, pause recruiting completely, because I need to make sure this project really stands out. And you come to this zone where almost 100% of your time is on that project. You're basically ignoring any other tasks. It's scary because you still have to solve those tasks at some point, but they have a timeline. And you can eventually notice when you get to this adjustment zone, that's what I call, that is like, okay, now I'm ready to shift back that time. And you can apply this to so many levels of your work, and it works pretty well. And it's also good to notice when you're burning out. So burnout happens when you're basically in the breakthrough point of something, simultaneously you're trying to keep doing the other tasks. And that usually what burns people out in the long run. So there is a way of achieving balance, but still grinding the important things when X is actually needed. And lastly, honestly, if you're not scared of leading or doing something new or growing your team, what's the point of doing it? So that's how we learn. That's why survival is super, super important. You know, imagine before this virus situation, which is so unfortunate. But before it, if I'll tell the IT team that I want to put the whole effects team to work from offsite, people laugh. People are like, this is impossible. Look at us, the whole studio is working from offsite and it works. So these are my lessons to you, or not lessons, just like my thoughts, and I'm sharing with you. I hope you find it valuable. Really hope so. Just so you're aware, we're actually doing a virtual career fair for Houdini CFX artists and Houdini FX artists alike. I think we'll do it later. We are now fully Houdini CFX. So we built a lot of the pipeline. We're looking at some PDG solutions as well. Super interested. So if you're interested in that, have a look. The link is just below. And I would like to thank you for myself. If you have any questions, please email me. I'll answer whenever I can. I hope you did find this talk valuable, despite not being full of nodes and Houdini stuff. That's why I usually do. Anyways, I wanted to share this with you guys. And you know, if you really like it, send me an email and say you like it. It's good to know. I might do more of these, more in detail as well. Thank you very much. Hudson, over and out.